عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers, I hope you, brothers and sisters, I hope you are well. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. Brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, before I move into the lecture, I would just like to mention a few things. The first thing is the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon every single person here today is that Allah azza wa jal gave them the success to come inside the masjid. To be sitting here on a Saturday night. I think a lot of us, we might take this for granted. But you find that how many people today, on this night, on a Saturday night, they are all over the place. Some of them are clubbing, some of them, like animals, have lost the plot. I think sometimes we tend to forget that this is a great benefit, a great blessing, bounty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon every single person. You never know, you could have been from those people who are running and jumping up and down in the club tonight. But Allah Azza wa Jalla, not only did He guide you to Al-Islam, but He guided you to come and establish the prayer in Al-Jama'ah. And then after this, we're sitting inside the lecture. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says in the Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you was to now enumerate the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would never be able to. Allah Azza wa Jalla also says in the Quran, وَآتَاكُم مِّن كُلِّ مَا سَأَلْتُمُوهُ. Allah Azza wa Jalla has given you everything that you asked for. So it's a great blessing that we should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only just thank Him whenever we want, we should hasten to thank Him Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a big blessing that wallahi we might look down upon and not even take into consideration. And who's the one that's benefiting? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in need of you for you to go and thank Him? Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Ya ayyuha nasu antum. Antum means you. Antum al-fuqara ila Allah. You are the ones that are in need of Allah Azza wa Jalla. What happens? If you go and thank Allah Azza wa Jalla, la in shakartum la azidannakum. You thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's going to what? Just increase for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might, because of you thanking Him, of being in the masajid of Allah Azza wa Jal, make you more firm upon His religion. And He keeps you firm upon the religion, حتى تلقاه, until you go and meet Allah Azza wa Jal. There's people that are in the masajid for years. Maybe something happens to them. They may have deviated away and they die while they are in a state of ignorance, in a state of haram. Maybe it was because they took it for granted and they never thanked Allah Azza wa Jal. How many do you find? Brothers and sisters, wallahi, we knew brothers who used to pray in the front line. Some of them, they used to lead taraweeh and tahajjud. Not just taraweeh, tahajjud. They would be from the first of the people to wake up. But then their hearts turned. This is why the Prophet ﷺ, time and time again, he used to constantly make dua to Allah Azza wa Jal. Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O turn of the hearts, keep my heart firm upon your religion. And also he came another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, فَإِذَا أَرَدْتَ لِعِبَادِكَ فِتْنَةً فَأَخْبُضْنِي إِلَيْكَ غَيْرَ مَفْتُونَ. If you want any fitna for your servant, then take my life while I'm not maftoon, trialed, someone that's infatuated to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while you are salim, in a good state. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also told us, and this shows us that we shouldn't get too complacent as well. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. A man, he keeps doing the actions of the people of Jannah. حَتَّى مَا يَكُونَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ الْجَنَّةِ إِلَّا ذِرَاعٍ. Until between him and the Jannah is just the length of an arm span. Between him and the Jannah is what's just the arm span. Just got a little bit out, little bit to go. فَيَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ فَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ النَّارِ فَيَدْخُلُهَا. The decree precedes him. He does the actions of the people of the fire. Just does the action. Right at the end of his life. He enters into it. He enters into the fire. This man has been doing the actions of the people of Jannah for so long. So that shows you, brother, and says, wallahi, we should hasten to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that which He has done for us. Sometimes we might not see the seriousness and the blessing that Allah Azza wa Jalla bestowed upon us until we might actually just fall into it. The hole we fell into it. I remember one day I was like this. You start thinking to yourself, brothers and sisters, the hadith that the brothers advertised, اغتنم خمس قبل الخمس. Seek or seize benefit of five before five. Before I move into inshallah ta'ala explaining the hadith, a question that I would like to ask and also put forth to every single individual is, are we ready to leave this world today? A question we ask ourselves, are we ready now? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to seize our souls, are we ready to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that which we have? Who today can say this to themselves, I am ready, from the actions that I have done? Or is death even something that we think about? From the moment that we wake up, how am I going to perfect my ibadah today? If I was to die, brothers and sisters, how many times has this happened? Just America. You find that the place gets hit by a tornado or an earthquake. And don't think to yourself, it can't happen to you. You think the earthquake called them and said, we're coming. It came and took them in the state they were in. It could have been good, it could have been bad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَالْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ. Let a person look at what he has prepared for tomorrow. That's why Umar ibn al-Khattab used to constantly say, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. Hold yourself to account. With the action that I do on a day-to-day basis, is that enough for me? Wallahi, one of my family members, just the other day, I think it was the 23rd of March, I got sent a message, happy birthday. It totally crossed my mind that it was my birthday today. The birthday that they call it. A question we should ask ourselves, is it something to be happy about that we are now 1 year closer to our death? People, they get excited, they rejoice. When it's their birthday, when they reach the age of 24, 25, is it something to be happy about that we are now 1 year closer to our death? 1 year closer to our death, 1 year closer to the grave. That one is going to be in 10 feet down under the floor. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَالْتَنْظُرْ. O you who believe, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and see what you have prepared for tomorrow. You know, we've heard this ayah maybe a billion times. And I'm going to mention inshallah ta'ala for a billionth and one time. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I never created the ins, the human and the jinn, except for one purpose, to worship me alone. What does it actually mean? Is it part of our lives? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I never created the jinn and the ins except for my worship. Me and you haven't been placed in Britain except for one purpose, nothing else. Without a shadow of a doubt, we need to work. We need to go and get the education. I'm not trying to belittle getting an education, we all are. Something that even I take very, very seriously, studying a degree. But when we wake up in the morning and we set out, how closely do we look at the ibadat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for, and that alone? You know, studying these things and chasing after money, dollars, and everything else becomes a big fat problem. When it begins to busy you away from your main objective, which is the ibadah. We're not here to just play around, to just live here for 20 years and then get off. Allah says, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا. Does one think that we created him for a purpose, without a purpose? To, for a joke? أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ يُتْرَكَ سُدَى. Does man think that he's been created without an aim? Or are we from those that when they wake up in the morning, the first thing that pops to their mind, how am I going to go today and perfect my ibadah? The one and only thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created me for and placed me in Luton or Leicester or Leeds, in any other place. Or are we from those whose hearts are distracted? We are in ghafla, unmindfulness, swimming in it. We don't know what is going on, what day of the week it is, because the work has busied us so much. Allah says, اِخْتَرَبَ لِلنَّاسِ حِسَابُهُمْ وَهُمْ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مُعْرِضُونَ. The hour has become close. The hisab has become close. وَهُمْ فِي غَفْلَةٍ. Heedlessness, they are what? They are drowning in it. مُعْرِضُونَ, they keep turning away. Allah then says, لَاهِيَةً قُلُوبُهُمْ. Their hearts are distracted. With what? With the beautification of this dunya. Brothers and sisters, I want to ask you a question. What is the meaning of Allahu Akbar? I'm sure most of us, we know the meaning of Allahu Akbar. Huh? You, I think I know Somali, yes. Huh? Allah is the greatest, or He's just great? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the greatest. Allahu Akbar means Allah is the greatest. 99% of the people, they know the meaning of what Allahu Akbar. But even though we might say with our tongues, our lives built around, when we hear Allahu Akbar, we put every single thing that we're doing down. We might say with our tongue, nobody in this room is going to say that that football game, the El Clasico, the Champions League game, is what? Bigger than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, greater than Him. Or wherever other show that one is watching, East Enders, Coronation Street, all this stuff. Or even your books, maths, English, science, Pythagoras theorem, condensation, alliteration. Nobody here is going to say that these things are both bigger and greater than Allah Azza wa Jal. Nobody would. But even though we might not say it with our tongues, our actions show that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not greater. Do we submit straight away when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's prayer is called? Straight away we stand up and we leave everything that we're doing. The true meaning of Allahu Akbar is what? That we stand up to Him straight away. Bilisan al-Hal, we are saying what? That Ronaldo and Messi are greater than Allah Azza wa Jal if you carry on watching that game. My boss is greater. My wife is better. If we tend to what? Give these priority over Allah Azza wa Jal. Brothers and sisters, wallahi, if you look at our lives closely, are we worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or worshipping the boss? Are we worshipping Allah Azza wa Jalla or worshipping the wife? 8:50, work starts at 9 a.m. Zah, we are there, 8:50. Every single day of the week we are there, 8:50. Why? Because we want the boss to say what? Oh, this guy is mashallah, comes early, determined. We care more about what the boss has to say about us. It's going to look good on our records. When it comes to Dhuhr prayer, Fajr prayer, Asr prayer, every other prayer, and the time of Adhan is going, do we give it the same importance? The wife tells us to pick us up, to pick her up from the center or from her work, from a teaching job, wherever it might be. Primary school, she's working there. You're late for 5 minutes, she becomes upset. The next day, we're 15 minutes earlier there. But is that the same, you know, way we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's religion, do we give so much importance to it just like that? You know Imam al-Shafi rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, فَإِذَا أَرَدْتَ أَن تَعْرِفَ مَقَامَكَ فَانْظُرْ فِي مَقَامَكَ. If you really want to know your position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then see what actually made you stand up, or the position that you have with Him. This dunya, brothers and sisters, wallahi, that we're chasing is cursed. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, الدنيا ملعونة ملعون ما فيها إلا ذكر الله. This dunya is cursed. Everything in it is cursed as well, except for a few things. ذكر الله, the remembrance of Allah عز وجل, وما والاه وعالما ومتعلما, the guy that learns his religion and the guy that goes and teaches it. How do we look at life? Is it like this or is it acts? I'm going to give you, brothers and sisters, a hadith. Wallahi. Memorize this hadith, write it in gold and carve it in a stone. Wallahi, the whole way you look at life is going to change. The things that you're chasing, if the one wallahi truly looks at this hadith, وَيَصْدُقُهَا, and he has, is truthful to himself, truthful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you find whatever he's doing, totally he's going to look at it completely differently. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ كَانَتِ الدُّنْيَا هَمَّهُ. Whoever makes the dunya his main priority, فَرَّقَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرًا, his affairs will be torn apart. Just because you made the dunya your main priority. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَجَعَلَ فَقْرَهُ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْنِ, poverty will be placed between his eyes. وَلَمْ يَأْتِهِ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَا كُتِبَ لَهُ, and the only thing that will come to him in this dunya except that which was written down for him. Why? Because you made the dunya your main priority. That's all you cared about, the dollars and the pounds. How I'm gonna stack up. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, وَمَنْ كَانَتِ الْآخِرَةُ نِيَّتَهُ جَمَعَ اللَّهُ لَوْ أَمْرَهُ. Whoever makes the akhirah his main priority, his main objective, there's no problem. Carry on doing your thing. But Allah Azza wa Jalla is your main priority. جَمَعَ اللَّهُ لَوْ أَمْرَهُ. Your affairs will come together. Allah Azza will sort you out. وَجَعَلَ غِنَاهُ فِي قَلْبِهِ. Richness will be placed in your heart. وَأَتَتْهُ الدُّنْيَا وَهِيَ رَاغِمَةٌ. The dunya will be dragged to him. You want a car, you want a house, you want everything else. These materialistic things are gonna come chasing after you. It is mujarrab, something that has been tried and seen. The dunya is gonna come chasing after you, will be dragged to you. Why? Because you made Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the main priority. You never allowed all of these mashagil. Brothers and sisters, don't think Jannah is just gonna come like that. Us sitting back on the sofa, couch, lying back, feet up, relaxed. There's temptations. There's all sorts of temptations. The one is going to be dragged into, his heart's gonna get distracted. Allah says, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولَ أَمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Does man think that he'll be left alone and he's not gonna be trialed, tribulation ain't gonna come to him? وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّا الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. We've trialed those before you. وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّا الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. And we come to know who is truthful in his ways and those who are liars. Make that your main priority, brothers and sisters. This hadith is about that. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is informing you, take opportunity of five before five. Seize it. Don't let it get away from you. Take it and make it precious. I'll ask you a question here. Does anyone have a debit card? Most people have debit cards. Where'd you do it? What'd you do with it? Everyone keeps it in their pockets, locks it up. The money that you have? Wallahi, one brother one time told me, his family, نعم and this just sums up Bani Adam. The love that they have for wealth. This family was doing something called benefit food. So they can't keep the money in the bank. They keep it inside the house. The house can never ever be empty. Day and night somebody has to look after it. Everybody leaves, one person has to stay. They constantly, يعني, they have that eagerness in trying to preserve these materialistic things. The money. That's how a deen should be. The ahadith that we learn, we should see it as very, very precious. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us to take opportunity of five before five. اغتنم خمس قبل القمس. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, شبابك اغتنم خمسا قبل خمس شبابك قبل هرمك. Your youth before you become old. Brother and sister, you know Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he mentioned a very, very powerful statement. Very, very powerful. He said, عليكم بالعلم فإن أحدكم لا يدري متى يفتخر إلى ما عنده. Upon you is to seek knowledge. Learn the knowledge. Take it seriously. فإن أحدكم. For indeed you don't know. There will come a time when the people will be in need of that which you possess. عليكم بالعلم. He then again said, upon you is to seek knowledge. قبل ذهاب العلماء. Before the ulama, the possessors of knowledge, they leave. They leave this dunya. Why did Abdullah ibn Mas'ud say this? When did he say this? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, brothers and sisters, he's seen that people used to take knowledge from who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then they took it from Abu Bakr and Umar. And then there came a time when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was being taken from. Do you really think that people normally take from those who are young? If you're 14, 13 years old, people don't tend to take you seriously. But when you get older, people tend to take you more seriously after that. And the knowledge you have, people tend to benefit from you. But when do you start seeking knowledge? When you reach the age of 20, 25, 30? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was studying, brothers and sisters. He was studying from a very young age. He lived a very long life after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He even said it by himself, ما من آية في كتاب الله إلا وأنا أعلم فيما نزلت وأين نزلت. There's not an ayah in the book of Allah عز وجل except that I know where it came down upon and who it came down upon. ولو كنت أعلم أحدا أعلم مني بكتاب الله تبلغ المطايا لذهبت. If I knew that someone was more knowledgeable than me when it came to the Quran and my riding camel could reach it, I would go. It came in some narrations that nobody rebuked Abdullah al-Mas'ud in regards to this statement. Why? Because they knew Abdullah al-Mas'ud, he was knowledgeable, he knew the Quran. From a very young age, he would study. And there came a time when the people were with him. Same thing with Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas was young. A man from the Ansar one time said, Ibn Abbas, do you think that the people are going to be in need of you and amongst them is the other companions? And amongst you is the other companions. Do you think people are going to need you? Abdullah ibn Abbas, he did not take the kalam seriously and he carried on. فَأَعْرَضْتُ عَنْهُ. I turned away from him and I carried on. He turned away from him, brothers and sisters. He did not want to hear out what the guy was saying and he carried on. There came a time when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, everybody was sitting around him. Everybody was sitting around Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. That same man, he came and he saw him. He said, كَانَ هَذَا الْفَتَى أَعْقَلَ مِنِّي. This boy, this young boy, he was more smarter than me. Abdullah ibn Abbas, brothers and sisters, you know in some countries, the Arab world, door time they sleep because it's hot. Very, very hot. The heat is unbearable. Abdullah ibn Abbas would go to what? To go and get a hadith. He would sit in front of the houses. He would knock, nobody would open, and he would sit there. The wind was sandy, not the wind that we have in Britain, mashallah. Dust particles were filled in it. He would put something around his face to protect his eyes and his face. He's waiting, waiting for that person to come out in order to write down that hadith. There will come a time when the people are going to benefit from him. As that Ansari said, كَانَ هَذَا الْفَتَى أَعْقَلَ مِنِّي. This fata, this young boy, he was more smarter than me. Without a shadow of a doubt, Abdullah ibn Abbas, there was other people that people were going back to in his time. They might not have gone back to him. There was even a time when Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu, he wanted to enter him into the sittings as Shaykh al-Badr. So they felt like, why is Abdullah ibn Abbas being entered upon us? We have kids the same age as him. He was young then. And he carried on and he carried on and he carried on. Imam fi tafsir. He became one of the greatest and most knowledgeable when it came to knowing the Quran. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made du'a, Allahumma allimhu ta'wil. Oh Allah, teach him the interpretations. Allahumma allimhu al-Quran. Allahumma faqihu fi deen. Oh Allah, give him understanding in the religion. And he brought out, you know, sometimes to know the weight of a scholar is the students that he brought out. He brought people like Mujahid, Ata, Tawus. You go to books of Ibn Kathir, Tabari, all these other books of tafsir, you find these names. Who did they come out of? Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu. Mujahid, Sufyan al-Thawri, another great tabi'i, he mentioned about him. إذا جاءك التفسير من مجاهد فحسبك. If a tafsir not come from Mujahid, it is sufficient. They knew. Brothers and sisters, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he's telling you of his experience so you can take the same opportunity. عليكم بالعلم فإن أحدكم لا يدري متى يفتخر إلى ما عنده. Upon you to seek knowledge, for indeed you don't know. There might be a time when the people are in need of what you have. Don't belittle yourself. There's enough scholars around. There's enough speakers around. Why can't it be you? There might be a time when you, the people, are going to need what you have, even though it might not be now. Or you might need to give a fatwa to yourself. You're in the middle of a desert. You don't have any water. What do? You use that knowledge for yourself and then use it for your family. Something very, very private happened to your wife. Things that you would never, ever discuss, ever even cross your mind, I need to discuss it with someone else. You're going to go and ask a sheikh of something that is very, very private between you and your wife? I mean like proper private, not problems, things that are pertaining you and your wife. You need to know yourself. There's no harm in doing that, but brothers and sisters, ilm is a sharaf. Take it very, very seriously, especially in your youth. Ali radiallahu anhu, he said, كَفَى بِالْعِلْمِ شَرَفًا أَن يَدَّعِيهِ كُلَّ مَنْ لَا يَحْسِنُهُ. It is enough to show you the honor of knowledge. That even if the guy, he's not knowledgeable, he gets excited. He even claims it to be knowledgeable. Everybody wants to claim knowledge. أليس كذلك؟ Few would you find saying, no, I don't have anything to do with it. Everyone wants to answer. That's just the human nature of a person. Then he said, وَيَفْرَحُ بِهِ إِذَا نُسِبَ إِلَيْهِ. He gets excited. Imagine an ignorant person, you say to him, أخي, you're knowledgeable. Wallah, he's going to get excited. He's going to get gassed, as they say. And then what? Ali radiallahu anhu, he then said, وَكَفَى بِالْمَرْءِ وَكَفَى بِالْجَهْلِ ذَمًّا أَنْ يَتَبَرَّأُ مِنْهُ كُلَّ جَاهِلٍ. And that which shows you the lowliness of ignorance that even the ignorant one, if you ascribe it to him, he gets angry. He doesn't want anything to do with it. لا يخفى على فضيلتكم, brothers and sisters, it's not hidden from you, the hadith of seven of those who are going to be under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the day when there's no shade except His. One of them is what? شابٌ نَشَى بِعِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ. A young boy who strove hard in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, I know the problem that we have sometimes in our society, that we give so much emphasis when it comes to what? Academics. Learning English, maths, wallahi, without a shadow of a doubt, it is important. But we tend to forget, we're in 2016, where the whole system is designed to pull a person away from his religion. Wallahi, let's not lie or fool ourselves. I went to school. 8 hours of the day, or the majority of the day, you're in the hands of the non-Muslims. You go into lessons like Ari. You go into lessons like Ari. Wallahi, they tell you, you know, you can learn whatever religion you want. Just like you have this religion has its positives, this one has its positives. Everyone's got their negatives. Wallahi, shubahat, ba'da shubahat. La nihayat laha. Doubts after doubts. I was teaching a group of sisters today, and the issue of philosophy came up. Because one sister asked, Ustad, what do you think of studying philosophy? So another sister said, I've studied it. In the second year, I jumped out. I left the course. Why? Because they give you doubts. They give you all sorts of doubts. You start doubting your religion. If you don't know your religion, wallahi, sooner or later, we're going to see you questioning if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is even present. Some brothers, wallahi, Somali brothers. There's one sheikh in Masjid Furqan in Leicester, Somali masjid, that we are connected to. The sheikh there, he would tell us, people that used to pray in the masjid, he's arguing with him, the presence of Allah azza wa jal. This is normally unheard of, brothers, for Muslim. Very rare. Time and time again, the atheism is corrupting the people. So billahi alaik, if we have now done that tarbiyah from a very young age, giving so much importance to the religion of Allah azza wa jal, the basics, we don't know it ourselves. Forget about the children, the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren. Those that come after them, billahi alaik, brothers and sisters, how do you expect them to know anything about the religion? If our kids are like that, they don't know one and two. How to put two and two together when it comes to the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's something that we need to be very, very fearful about and take very, very seriously. I always tell the brothers, wallahi, learn your religion now. Don't just think about yourself. I'm not going to need it. Think about your kids. Teaching them the basics of the religion. Books like Usul al-Thalatha, Qawa'id al-Arba, that everybody should be in a position to be able to teach at least to their siblings. They're very, very simple books. So they know what is halal, what is haram. And at the same time, if some of these doubts come to them, they know where to go back to the least. They know where to go. Who to ask. They don't just all put it through one ear and, you know, ends up affecting them. The second thing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned in the hadith was وَصِحَتَكَ قَبْلَ سَقَمِكَ. Your health before you become sick. I'm going to ask a question now. Labib, so I know your name in it, that's why. Huh. Have you ever been sick?
Of course, yeah.
Okay, طيب. You know the biggest illness you've ever had, how long did it keep you on the sofa for, on the bed?
2 weeks.
2 weeks, good. There's maybe other people who've been on their, you know, beds for like 4 weeks. They've been really, really ill. Brothers and sisters, imagine that you stayed in that position for the rest of your life. You know, one time in Ramadan, I was very, very ill. Half of the Ramadan, I didn't fast. I actually thought, khalas, I think my life maybe is coming to an end. It crossed my mind. You tend to find that you become more grateful about your siha, your health, when you become sick. What you want to do, even the things that you love to eat, you can't eat it. And again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling you, seize this opportunity while you are what? Healthy. You have the health. Go and worship Allah Azza wa Jal. Go and do Hajj. While you still have that strength. Some people, they find, wallahi, they're very old. They've never done Hajj before. Been Hajj many times. You see them, they're going around circumambulating the Kaaba. You speak to some of them, wallahi, they begin to even dislike Al-Islam. Because they're performing Hajj at a very old age. It's hard for them. The ibadah become very, very hard. You can't do the ibadah that you used to do before. The reward you miss out on. Hence why the Prophet ﷺ said, تَعَجَّلُوا لِلْحَجِّ فَإِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ لَا يَدْرِي مَا يُعْرَضُ عَلَيْهِ. Hasten to doing Hajj, for indeed you don't know what's going to come in front of you. You might become really, really ill. And you get held account. Why? Because you didn't take the opportunity when you was young and healthy. Your body was good. Huh? Your body was very, very good. MashaAllah, some of the youth and the kids you find, huh? He's got muscles now, they're taking selfies with each other. Your body looks beautiful. Excellent. You want the whole world to see. Seize that, use it in the correct way. Wallahi, they're not for the cameras. You might even get afflicted with ayn before you even move anywhere. You know, part of thanking Allah Azza wa Jalla, being thankful to Him, is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed you with is using in the ibadat. There's many ways to thank Allah Azza wa Jalla. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to thank Allah Azza wa Jalla through what? Through Qiyam al-Layl. Tahajjud. Used to pray for long hours. Used to pray for long hours, brothers and sisters. Wallahi. He used to pray for very long hours. Until Aisha radiallahu anha, she said to him, Ya Rasulullah, why do you do this to yourself? Allah Azza wa Jalla has forgiven your past and future sins. He said, Afala akuna abdan shakura? Shall I not be a thankful slave? It's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's trying to thank Allah Azza wa Jalla through his prayer. Through your bodies, these hands that you have, that we take for granted and today we use for haram. Wallahi, you're not being thankful to Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, and this ayah is very, very powerful. Brothers and sisters, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَذَهَبَ بِسَمْعِهِمْ وَأَبْصَارِهِمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. If Allah wanted, He will remove your ears, the hearing that you have, and the sight. Allah is able of all things. These bodies that you have, that mashallah you get so gassed about, you're so excited about. Imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ended up hitting you. You got afflicted with an affliction. Or the hearing that you have, you use it for haram. You listen to music with it. The eyes that Allah azza wa jalla blessed you with. What did you do with it? You watch things under your blanket. If these things were removed from your face, it was taken away from you, how would you feel? Again, we spoke in the beginning of being thankful to Allah Azza wa Jal. Wallahi, sometimes, you know, brother comes through the door, he's blind or he's on a wheelchair, we get very, very sorry, you know, we start to feel very, very sorry about this individual. We might even start crying. That boy is just wishing what you have taken for granted. To have maybe the eyes or the ability to speak. Brothers and sisters, صحتك قبل سقمك. Your health before you become sick. What you can do today, you won't be able to do tomorrow. And you will wish, if only I did this, I built that well, I spent that money there. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then said in the hadith, وغناك قبل فقرك فقرك sorry while you are rich before you become poor. Brothers and sisters, I don't think anyone here is as poor as how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. I don't think so. Is there anyone here that sometimes walks into his kitchen and has got nothing inside the fridge? Is there anyone here like that? We got benefits, huh? Something goes wrong. Or we go, you know, to the job center, we sign up, 250 is going to come through the door. I don't think anyone's been like that at all. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sometimes walking to his house, there's no food there. There was a time, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, exactly the same. He went to sleep, what happened? He went to sleep and he would try to sleep, but he wouldn't be able to sleep because of the jua, the hunger that he had. One time he left the house, Abu Bakr, because of hunger. He met Umar halfway. He asked him, "Man ladhi akhrajak? What took you out of your home?" The same thing that took you out of your home, al-jua, hunger. Tayyib. They carry on walking. They say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or actually they meet him and he says to them, "Man ladhi akhrajakuma? Why is that which took you out of your home?" The same thing that took you out of your home. Why am I mentioning this? After the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so poor, sometimes they would walk in their homes and they never had nothing. كان أجود ما يكون في رمضان وأجود من ريح المرسلة. He was the most generous when he came into the month of Ramadan. And just generally, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi was generous. Whatever he had, he would give. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi is telling you, the richness, the money that you have, you don't need to be rich. $5 million in your bank, nah. Wallahi, us, compared to the Sahaba, we are like millionaires. We have food, brothers. The mere fact that you have food in your fridge is a blessing that the companions sometimes never had. Brothers and sisters, are you telling me £2 a month or £3 a month, we can't set up a direct debit or a standing order to pay as charity? It is one of the actions, brothers and sisters, wallahi, that when a person leaves this dunya, he is going to wish that he what? He spent in charity. Allah Azza wa Jalla says to us, وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدُكُمْ الْمَوْتِ. Spend. Look how it's connected. Death and spending. And this hadith as well. Spend from that which we provided to you. Don't think that you went and earned that money through your own hands. لا والله. Allah Azza wa Jalla gave that to you. You're just giving it back. And on top of that, you're the one that's benefiting. وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدُكُمْ الْمَوْتِ before there comes death to you. فَيَقُولُ يَا رَبِّي فَيَقُولُ وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدُكُمْ الْمَوْتِ فَيَقُولُ. What was the ayah again? نعم جزاك الله خير. فَيَقُولُ لَوْلَا أَخَرْتَنِي إِلَى أَجَلٍ قَرِيبٍ. If only you latened it just a little bit. فَأَصَدَّقَ وَأَكُن مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. So I can go and give charity and be from those who are righteous. Charity. Even if it is small. Don't think, brothers and sisters, akhi is only 5p, 10p. Even if it is 1p, 2p, 5p, it's nothing. Because it's small and consistent, أَحَبُّ الدِّينِ لَلَّهِ أَدْوَمُهُ. The most beloved actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that which is consistent. وَإِنْ قَلَّ. Even if it is small. £5 a month. £6 a month. £10 a month. Wallahi, I don't think it's going to hurt the pockets. At all. We set that up on a standing order. تَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You see it to be small, but with Allah Azza wa Jalla, it's what? Great. From the names of the Akhirah, brothers and sisters, Yom Nadama, the day of regret. Don't be regretful. The money that you have now, small that you have, and on top of that, brothers and sisters, wallahi, the guy that is benefiting is you. Anfiq, yunfiq Allahu alayk. The Prophet said, spend, and Allah Azza wa Jalla will spend on you. People think they're losing money. La. The Prophet said, ما نقص مال من صدقتين. The wealth of a person doesn't decrease when it comes to what? Paying sadaqah. It doesn't decrease. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa swore by it. ثَلَاثَةٌ أَخْسِمُ بِهِنَّ. Three things I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. From them was, when a person spend, it doesn't what? Decrease him in wealth. You're benefiting. You're going to get more. Allah is going to look after you more. فَأَصَدَّقَ وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَفَرَاغَكَ قَبْلَ شُغْلِكَ. Your free time before you become what? Busy. Free time before you get busy. A lot of the single guys, mashallah, now they're free. Once you get married, you're gonna have a lock on your leg. You can't do the same thing you used to do before. Wallah, you can't. You have to discipline yourself. You'll realize when you get married, but just prepare yourself mentally now. The marriage brothers will advise you now. If you wanna maybe go out and maybe, you know, do more khair than you want to do, sometimes it gets difficult. A lot of people will lie, they find it difficult. Even if you wanna do khair, you wanna give lectures, you have to think about your family. There's two people you need to think about. Kids come. The kid wants this, the kid wants that. The kid needs you to take him to the school. The kid needs you to take him back. Half of your day is gone. That Quran you wanted to memorize. Brothers and sisters, wallahi, you're not going to have the same time. That's why the ulama, they always say memorize when you're small. Al-ilmu fi al-sighar kan-naqshi fi al-hajar. Learning knowledge while you're young is like carving into a stone. Does not carving get wiped away? It doesn't get wiped away. وَالْعِلْمُ فِي الْكِبَرِ كَكِتَابَةِ فِي الْمَا. And seeking knowledge when you're old is like what? Writing in water. Can you write on water? No, you can't. Difficult. But when you're young and you memorize and you learn, it sticks on your head. Then you can just go and revise. But when you're old, kids are bothering you, this guy's climbing on the back of your, he gets sick, she gets sick, then the wife, she says to you, you need to spend time with me. You haven't been spending any time with me. You're always with your kids. She has the right as well. I'm not trying to say that they're always right. You won't get the same time. Do not become regretful. For the people of Quran, brothers and sisters, wallahi, عندهم منزلة عظيمة عند الله عز وجل. They have a great status with Allah عز وجل. And I'll mention this one story, then inshallah I'll move on to the last part of the lecture. حياتك قبل موتك. Does anyone here know a man called Ibn Abi Abza? Does anyone here know Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu? Everybody does. Ibn Abi Abza was a servant. Can I ask you a question? Can I ask someone a question? You know, a servant, you ever make him, give him a high position in a community? Most people wouldn't. They wouldn't. Look what Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu did. He was leaving the city. He ran into Nafi' from the tremendous of the Tabi'een. He said to him, who did you leave the people with? He said, a man called Ibn Abi Abza. So Nafi' says to him, who is he? Like, never heard of him. He said to him, Mawla min Mawalina. A servant from the servants. A servant from the servants. So he says to him, you left the people with a servant. You place an authority of them, a servant, a slave. He says to him, إِنَّهُ عَالِمٌ بِالْفَرَائِدِ. He knows the faraid. He knows what Allah Azza wa Jalla has made compulsory, where he has made halal and haram. Do you not hear the statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla? Sorry, the statement of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْفَعُ بِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ أَقْوَامًا وَيَضَعُ بِهَا آخَرِينَ. Allah subhanahu will raise a person due to his accordance to the Quran, and other people will be humiliated, will be put down. So this servant, just a random guy, Allah Azza wa Jalla raised him in the eyes of the people. He became raised in the eyes of Umar ibn Khattab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't forget. And he doesn't fail in his promise. وَعْدَ اللَّهِ لَا يُخْلِفُ اللَّهُ وَعْدَهُ. Came another hadith on يوم القيامة. يقال لصاحب القرآن اقرأ وارتقي ورتل. Read, recite, write. كما كنت ترتل في الدنيا. Just like he used to recite the book in the dunya. فَإِنَّ مَنْزِلَتَكَ عِنْدَ آخِرِ آيَةٍ تَقْرَأُ. For indeed your status is the last place he was reading the Quran. How many elders, parents I've met, they wished that they memorized the Quran at a very young age. They put effort into the Quran. But like they say, too late to change. It's difficult now. The guy has got to look after his family. He misses out on these fada'il, these virtues. And then the last thing that was mentioned in the hadith, brothers and sisters, حياتك قبل موتك. Your life before your death. Is there anyone here who's been given a guarantee when he's going to die? Wallahi, no one has. Brothers and sisters, wallahi, thumma billahi, thumma tallahi, malakul maut is not going to call you and say to you, I'm coming. The angel of death. You're not going to get a private message on Facebook or someone's going to WhatsApp you, listen, akhi, get ready, prepare yourself, I'm coming. Ya'tikum baghta, as Allah Azza wa Jalla says, it'll come to you unexpectedly. But the question is, are you ready? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kun fi dunya ka annaka gharib aw aabir sabil." Be in the dunya as a stranger, or someone that's just, you know, traveling. What happens when you're traveling? You got all your stuff with you, my clothes, my passport, the money that I love so much, carrying it. You're always just ready. Train's coming, I'm ready to go on, ready to move. That's how one should be when he's in his dunya. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, فَإِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرَ الْمَسَاءِ. When you wake up in the morning, don't wait for the night. Don't wait for it. Be ready, as they say, stay on your toes. فَإِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرَ الصَّبَاحِ. When you go to sleep, don't wait for the morning. You might never ever wake up. Even though the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to us, أَعْمَارُ أُمَّتِي بَيْنَ 60 وَسَبْعِينَ. The average lifespan of a person is between 60 and 70. وَقَلِيلٌ مَا يَتَجَاوَزُ ذَلِكَ. Few are those who actually go over it. And on top of that, wallahi, you're not guaranteed. Young people that we knew, that were studying with us, they've died at the age of what, 19, 20. Do you wake up in the morning thinking this could be my last day? It could be my last breath. I might die. You might walk on the road and get clapped one time by the car and you're dead. And people are praying your janazah the next day. Are you ready? كن في الدنيا كأنك غريب. Be in this dunya as if you're a stranger. Or عابر سبيل, someone that's traveling. We're going to do a bit of maths now. People are good at maths. I'm going to ask a few questions. You know how we mentioned the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the average lifespan of a person is what, between 60 and 70. Let's just pick out 60. Brother, can I ask you, the brother with the lovely hair, mashallah. Huh? How many hours a day do you normally sleep?
Seven.
Let's just say 8 to make it easier. Because I, you know, sometimes... And the doctors say that as well, you need to sleep 8 hours in order to, you know, قال الدكتور, the doctor said. طيب. That's a third, صح? That's a third of your day. 8 hours is a third of your day. A third of your day is going to what? Sleep. What's a third of 60? 20. 20 years of your life has gone to what? Sleeping. طيب. Another 8 hours a day which we spend where? At work. 9 to 5 is 8 hours. Okay, another 20 of your years of your life you spent where? Under the boss. How many left? 20. Let's just say, you know, the time when you spend time with your family or you know, football and things like that, watching other stuff and things like that. In your day, how many hours do you do it? 5. To make things easy. 5 hours a day. Who can give me the ratio of 5 hours in a day? So the mathematicians will...
524.
That's just a fraction, I need the number. 25%. To make things easy, 25%. I hope that's right. 25% of what? The remaining 20 years. Which is? That's another 5 off, you've got 10 years left. And then the rest of the things that you do, using the toilet. Yani, how many things in a day do we do? Eating. Let's just say another 5 years. You have 5 years, brothers and sisters. 5 years in your whole lifetime. To make that solely for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and protect it. That's for those who do this amount of hours into these kind of things. It's up to you how you go about sorting your things out. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, Allah Azza wa Jalla tells in the Quran about those who become regretful. When death has come to them and they've come on the day of resurrection and they're chucked into the fire. وَهُمْ يَصْطَرِخُونَ فِيهَا رَبَّنَا أَخْرِجْنَا نَعْمَلْ صَالِحًا غَيْرَ الَّذِي كُنَّا نَعْمَلْ. And they're drowning inside a fire. They're being hurt, they're being burnt. And don't think the fire there is like the fire in this dunya. The Prophet said, النَّارُ الَّتِي تُوْخِنَا جُزْءٌ مِنْ سَبْعِينَ جُزْءَ. 1/70 of the fire that you have in the Akhirah. 1/70. Go touch the fire, you can't bear it. One time I actually pushed a brother onto the barbecue. He was ill for 1 week. That's the kind of damage that you can do on a person. It's not the same. What will they be wishing? If only we could go back. لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْ كَلَّا إِنَّا كَلِمَةٌ وَقَائِلُهَا. Too late. The action that you could have done, too late. Can't do anything else. You know, on Yawm Al-Qiyamah, and inshallah ta'ala concluded this, I see a brother, it's a warning sign. When a person gets chucked into the fire, Allah Azza wa Jalla quotes these mujrimeen. And I'm going to mention 4 ayat inshaAllah ta'ala. From the matalib, the request that they have. The first one is what? Allah Azza wa Jalla says, quoting these people, رَبَّنَا أَخْرِجْنَا مِنْهَا فَإِنْ عُدْنَا فَإِنَّا ظَالِمُونَ. Oh Allah, take us out. فَإِنْ عُدْنَا فَإِنَّا ظَالِمُونَ. If we go back to what we was doing, we are oppressors. It will be said to them, اِخْسَأُوا فِيهَا وَلَا تُكَلِّمُونَ. يعني, in a humiliating way, they're told to keep quiet, don't speak. You're too late. They will realize that they can't ask Allah Azza wa Jal. So who did they turn to? The God of the fire. وَنَادُوا يَا مَالِكُ لِيَقْضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكَ قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. They ask what? The gatekeeper of the fire. Ask Allah Azza wa Jal. Ask him. If you could khalas, just bring it to an end. It is said to them, you're going to stay in there. إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. So they've lost hope now in this as well. The third one. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ فِي النَّارِ لِخَزَنَةِ جَهَنَّمْ أُدْعُوا رَبَّكُمْ يُخَفِّفْ عَنَّا يَوْمًا مِنْ الْعَذَابِ. They will say to the gatekeeper, ask your Lord, okay, we realize now we can't come out. Lighten the fire, lighten the punishment. يُخَفِّفْ عَنَّا just يَوْمًا يَوْمًا مِنْ الْعَذَابِ, just one day. قَالُوا أَوَلَمْ تَكُ تَأْتِيكُمْ رُسُلُكُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ قَالُوا بَلَى فَادْعُوا مَا دُعَاءُ الْكَافِرِينَ إِلَّا فِي ضَلَالٍ. Didn't a messenger come to you, explain to you what is right, what is wrong, warn you? When they realize, خلاص, they can't do that as well. The last request that they have, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَادُوا أَصْحَابُ الجنة أصحاب النار. أنا فيض علينا من الماء أو مما رزقهم الله. The people in the fire, they will ask the people of Jannah to shower them with the water that they have, the drink that they have, or mimma razaqhum Allah, or from that which Allah Azza wa Jalla provided for you. And it is haram upon them. They're not going to get nothing because they wasted it. They'll be wishing they could go back, and from the names of the day of judgment, Yawmun Nadama, the day of regret. Too little, too late. And brothers and sisters, wallahi, I'll just conclude with this. Turn your life around. Think about it. Today, these brothers who have organized the lecture, they never just organized for everyone to just, you know, put it through one ear and take out the other. It's amal and ittiba, that you act upon it and you follow it. Otherwise, wallahi, it's a whole waste of time for the organizers, the people that have attended, the speaker. What's the point? They're meant to be for us to actually, you know, use our heads, our intellect, and come back running to Allah Azza wa Jal. Please, brothers, the Salaf, and when I mention brothers Salaf, I mean the three golden generations. The Sahaba, the Tabi'in, the Tabi'in, Tabi'in. Today people are allergic to the word Salaf. It just means the Sahaba, the Tabi'in, the Tabi'in, Tabi'in. A person, قولاً وعملاً واعتقاداً. That's what Salafiyya means. Your statement, your action, and your belief, it needs to be in accordance to what? The way of the Sahaba. That's what Salafiyya means. As for someone to come and just have bad etiquette, or maybe just believe it, but at the same time you don't act upon it, this is not Salafiyya. It's just a claim and it's not action. What we spoke about, wallahi, it is the same thing that the Sahaba came to us with. We told you what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas came with. It's upon a person to act upon it and to take it on board and to take it seriously and to apply it into his life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and afwan, I went over. Wait, 4 minutes. I'll pay back later. And I think that's yakfi, inshallah.
Anyone got any questions about this specific subject matter? Or any other questions? We've got about 5 minutes before the salah, probably. It's not about the subject, but you mentioned that you were studying Sufi. You met the brothers from that time. How would you go out with them?
Like how I went from being in the Sufi camp to...
So how would you guide them?
Okay. You know, firstly, one, he needs ikhlas, wallahi. To be sincere in what he's looking for. Firstly, what we can advise the brother is to read the dua, Allahumma arina al-haqq al-haqq waj warzuqna at-tiba'a. Oh Allah, provide for us or give us the ability to follow and to guide us to what is the truth. For indeed the dua is something that is very, very major that one should, you know, constantly remind himself with it. And it's something that after I became very, very confused, I would constantly ask Allah Azza wa Jal with this dua, وَرْزُخْنَا اتِّبَاعَ, and, you know, provide for us to follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that which is correct. You find that if a person is sincere in doing and wanting the truth, just like Salman al-Farisi. Salman al-Farisi likewise was misguided before he came to Al-Islam. Story, he went to so many religions. But that sidq was in his heart. إِن يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا يُؤْتِكُمْ خَيْرًا. Allah says, if that khair is found in your heart, He will give you that khair. As for one just saying, أخي, you are like this. He doesn't want anything to do, doesn't even want to listen. Then you can't do anything for this person. And thirdly, to maybe advise this individual of the purity of this da'wah. Because Allah, as we mentioned before, brothers and sisters, this da'wah is nothing but قال الله
قال الرسول قال الصحابة لا للتمويه ما العلم نصبك للخلاف سفاهة بين الرسول وبين رأي فقيه. This religion is قال الله قال الرسول قال الصحابة. No, my sheikh said. I respect my sheikh. I love him. But even the sheikh are asking for proof. He's not like just a peer there that I'm going to accept everything that he says. La, the sheikh is there to teach you that which is inside Bukhari and Muslim and the Quran. Nothing else. And that's what makes this da'wah different from other da'wah. The purity of it, taking it back to Allah Azza wa Jal, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what the Sahaba said, not my dad's understanding. I love my dad. But his understanding is not the understanding of my religion, or my mom's, or my sheikh, or the sheikh's sheikh. Sahaba Ridwan, how they saw it, that's how we take it. And that's very, very important that one makes clear, inshallah ta'ala, when maybe explaining to them these kind of things.